Good afternoon. I'm particularly excited about this panel for two reasons. One, there's so many people I've long admired and respected on it, so this is just a privilege for me to have the chance to ask them questions and then listen to whatever questions you may pose to them. So I hope you will tweet questions using the hashtag CGIU so that we can surface as many of those as possible. And the second reason I'm particularly excited about this panel is because I know at least we on the stage share a belief that we learn a tremendous amount from the unintended consequences of our efforts, and that our subsequent tries are more likely to be successful because of what we expected and did not expect to learn from when our efforts may not have reached the hoped for aspirations initially. So I'm just could not be more thrilled and grateful to all of our panelists and to all of you for being part of this conversation this afternoon. You know, Raj, I want to start with you and quote something that you've said that I resonate with, that we should fail often but fail small to scale things we have more confidence in. Could you talk a little bit about how you applied that thinking to your time at the helm of USAID, and also just to your life in general?
Well, thank you, Chelsea. The first part of that is easier to answer than the second one. I had a wonderful opportunity to run the U.S. Agency for International Development under President Obama and Secretary Clinton. And one of the things we wanted to do was allow more people, especially kind of interdisciplinary groups of scientists and students, engineers and entrepreneurs, to work together to solve some of the toughest problems out there. So one of the things we did was we created the U.S. Global Development Lab. And I believe Anne-Mae Chang, who runs the lab and is an outstanding leader from Google who we recruited into government, is here somewhere. I hope you'll all find her. But I was amazed at the kind of innovation we were able to support and unlock to tackle some of the toughest problems. And you can only innovate like this if you're willing to take some risks and fail. We launched an effort called Saving Lives at Birth, and I personally met these student groups from medical schools across the country that were developing new devices and new technologies that could save children's lives in rural Malawi right at the point of birth by reducing infection risk or creating opportunities to prevent children from dying of birth asphyxia, the inability to breathe. In an environment where they're not in a hospital and they don't have access to expensive technology and skilled workers to help save their lives. And what I learned from the effort was everyone, when we did this, said, oh, the U.S. Congress will never let you, you know, develop programs that are designed to support high-risk innovations that might then fail. And certainly you should never tell a member of Congress that you took public monies and failed at something, because it puts everything at risk. I actually found the opposite was true. If we were honest and open, and we said the sole purpose of this is to develop great new technologies and ideas and approaches to solving some of the world's toughest problems, we could win support on both sides of the aisle. And we were able to do that. Today, the Global Development Lab has programs called the Grand Challenges for Development. They have a venture fund that actually supports new entrepreneurial efforts that are trying to fight poverty by studying and evaluating the performance of their applications. And we're starting to see these things make a huge difference in the global fight to end child death, to expand the reach of agricultural programs, to end child hunger, and so many other applications that I know many of you in this room care about. So I hope you'll look at the lab. On a personal basis, I'll just say I don't know how much I've learned, but I have certainly had the opportunity to succeed and fail a number of times. And I'll just say I've learned more from the failures, both about who your true friends are, as well as how to kind of go after problems and tackle them in the future. One of the things we did when I was at the Gates Foundation was we issued a bond, actually raising $6 billion for global immunization. And we get a lot of credit for how innovative and creative that was. What people don't realize was we tried to issue that bond each of the 3 years previously and failed each time. And it wasn't until we got the financial structure and the guarantee structure correct around it that we were able to use the capital markets to help expand immunization for now 440 million children who otherwise wouldn't have received it. So I'm a big fan of failing, so long as you're surrounded by people who you know, are going to be there to support you, and you learn from those mistakes.
You know, Primal, oh, please. Primal, we were talking backstage about how obvious Kiva seems now, given the density of people who've participated, those like me, who have been lenders on Kiva, and the kind of thousands of people that you've helped empower through Kiva around the world. But it was not so obvious when you first had this idea while you were working at PayPal. And you talked backstage about some of the walls that you ran into. Could you talk a little bit about kind of what you learned from those walls that you had to kind of break through or go around? And also, for those in the audience who may not know what Kiva.org is, just explain a little bit about your platform.
Sure. Well, Kiva is a website, and our mission is to connect people through lending to alleviate poverty. And the whole idea is that we believe that there's, you know, millions of people with a little bit of money that they would be willing to invest in millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of other people who have an idea and could make some money if someone was willing to invest in them. So online microfinance. And for many of you social entrepreneurs here who have a earned income stream in your model, you can look at the Kiva website as a way to raise 0% interest capital from the crowds. And, you know, to date, 10 years in, over 1.8 million small businesses in 80 countries have received nearly $1 billion from 1 million people on the internet. And when we first started, this idea of person-to-person microfinance across wealth and geographic divides, although it was this beautiful concept, we had no idea if it was A, legal, right? Could someone in Des Moines, Iowa invest in someone in Tororo, Uganda? Or B, how you'd actually get the repayments to come? And there was all sorts of walls, if you will, that we bumped into. Let me give one example. What makes Kiva a little different than a typical crowdfunding website is that you actually get repaid if you lend on it, and then you can recycle the money over and over. But then we had to figure out the repayment. And as we were going in that first year, we realized that the local institutions that we're partnered with to administer the loans that the internet lenders were lending, basically the repayments stopped coming in. And our system requirement was that you had to actually upload a repayment every time you collected from someone in the field. And the given how thin the bandwidth was in East Africa where we're working, and sometimes the power would go out, essentially while our local microfinance partners were collecting from the clients in the field, the folks that they had posted up on the Kiva website, they actually couldn't actually load the pages on our site. So we moved in conversation with them. We realized, geez, you know, they're collecting 95% of the time in microfinance. Why don't we move to an exception-based system where you only have to report when someone hasn't repaid as opposed to when they have repaid? That greatly saves the work for the local partners on the ground to use this crowdfunding platform in a low bandwidth environment. And then the repayments started coming again. And I would say Kiva is a series of just thousands of small tweaks like that of letting the work teach us. So it's important to have an intention and then improvise and to have a conversation with those that you're working with to continually adapt the system. And you know, as Raj said, it's not failure, it's really reframing it as learning every single day.
And it sounds like you're still learning, is that fair?
Still learning, still bumping into a lot of walls.
So can you just share some of the recent tweaks that you've had to make?
Probably the most profound one is when we started Kiva 10 years ago, there was so much hype around microfinance being nearly a silver bullet for poverty alleviation. And what's come to light over the last several years is actually microcredit isn't as impactful as we once thought. So here we are, the retail face of microcredit. And a lot of randomized control trials came out saying, hey, you know what? People aren't as well off as we thought they might have been. And then there was instances of people becoming over indebted from loans. And the whole goal is to help people build assets. So we really had to rethink our impact. Big does not equal good, right? And we had to start thinking, wait, how do we channel the internet community's 0% interest, risk-tolerant capital in a way that actually is impactful? And so what we've done, for example, I'll give one example. What we realized is one of the things that makes microcredit actually not as impactful as it could be is that it's frequent repayment schedules. You have to pay back every month. But if you can have grace periods, so for example, if you're a farmer and you don't have to pay back the loan until you've actually harvested and sold your crops, that can actually make that loan more productive for you, and you can actually have a higher ROI on that borrowing. And so what we're trying to do is constantly tweak Kiva to actually go where the markets don't go and where we think that there's an impact hypothesis where microcredit could function better if we can show high repayment rate and ultimately crowd in local banks to start doing this kind of more patient lending.
Wow. You're nodding a lot.
A lot of agreement.
So, yes, please feel free to applaud and respond in whatever way you want and whenever you're so moved to. I think I read that you had 54 different prototypes of solar cookers.
That's correct.
Yes. So clearly also lots of walls. So maybe kind of why you're nodding so enthusiastically and kind of sympathetically. Could you talk a little bit about kind of what you learned through those different iterations and how your kind of final product offerings were just that much stronger, and also share a little bit about One Earth Designs for people who may not be as familiar with your work?
Absolutely. So I think many people in the audience today might be aware that the biggest global health challenge we face is household air pollution from cook stoves. It kills 4.3 million people every year. And so my company focuses on trying to solve that by making these awesome solar-powered stoves that reach the same temperatures as a regular stove and heat up 5 times faster. That's what we do. We have customers all over the world now, but we started out in a small community up in the Himalayas. And when we started, we were trying to solve this problem by building improved versions of the traditional adobe stove that people use locally, improving the combustion chambers, adding on chimneys. And we faced two problems in the way of this. One is that the families we were working with migrated 7 times every year. And every time they had to build a new stove. And every time it took an extra half day for that chimney to dry. So of course the men were impatient saying, where's my hot food? And then the second challenge we faced was that it's core to women's identity to build a good stove in these communities. So women were a bit embarrassed to go and ask each other how to do it. So instead, everybody came to me, and I became a tremendous roadblock in the way of scaling this technology. So completely unscalable. Big challenge number one. So I became quite frustrated with this situation and started asking people in the community for help. You know, what do we do? And one of the village elders said, you know, household air pollution is not our only problem. We also have a huge fuel scarcity problem as well. Every year, women are walking further and further to get to the forest. So we need a solution that solves that too. And so through lots of brainstorming, we came to this idea of trying to use the sun. And I literally went to one of the local factories, got a bunch of scrap materials, brought them into the center of the village, and we all started prototyping together. It was this incredible experience of everybody in the village getting excited, competing, trying to come up with different designs. It was a long pathway, 54 different developments over time, but finally we cracked it. And I just want to share, for the people out there who aren't designers, this type of approach is also really important throughout all the other aspects of your business. For example, we knew that we didn't want to rely on the government or foundations to fuel this. We wanted to create a real business. So we set out to try to do that and sell our products. Of course, most of the families that we were working with had almost no cash income. And everybody told us we were crazy to try to create a business. So again, we went out, we started talking to people and saying, what do you have in abundance if it's not cash? And it turned out that people had a lot of this medicinal herb that when we took it and we sold it in other cities in Asia, it was worth more than its weight in gold. So we ended up creating a barter-based business model that was actually hugely successful and profitable. So I really encourage all of you to look beyond failure to say, what is that key insight that can take me to success from this point? And always, I promise you, the answer will be there amongst your customers.
Wow, thank you. Before we get to Dr. Barry, Laura, I want to ask you, from an academic perspective, how do we study these different stories so that we are better able to kind of teach, inform, and effectively inspire so many of the students who are here and even more students who aren't here, whether in an undergraduate class or a business school class, because I know you certainly have stood in front of many of those. And so how do we kind of draw these lessons out in a way that is accessible and scalable to more people who can't be with us here today in rooms like this?
Well, luckily, I think we have a great deal of technology that can now help us do that. And I first want to really put all of this energy in this room in perspective in terms of my own sense of what universities do. Because if we think about the cases that have been discussed here, so there's basic science, there's applied science, there are scientists and researchers around the country, around the world, in research universities supported in part by governments, correctly by governments, to build up knowledge which can then be put to work in a Kiva, in a solar energy, in all of the things that USAID does. So you start with support for research. You can bring through things like CGIU or the Blum Center for Developing Economies or the various business plan competitions that probably are on the business school campuses of all of the universities out there. You can bring together mentors, judges, professors to teach. We have a hackathon weekends where people will come with an idea and you bring the judges and mentors together and a faculty member and the team sort of learn from one another. It's iterative. They're not going to solve the problem right there, but the next time they may solve the problem or they may solve some of the problem, bring down a wall. So universities are great places for convening people who are like-minded to try to solve a problem, then bringing all of the knowledge, mentorship, judgment to the teams. And then also, frankly, a very other important part of this is the networks that technology now lets us develop. So you may come to a hackathon or a week, a specialized week in microfinance and its effect on economic development. There might be a specialized course on that. At the end of that course, that doesn't mean it's over. You will have met, through that process, other people working in that area, and they will become part of your network. They will become part of the way in which you share information and learn. I think many, many business schools and universities, many, many now, are doing all of these things. And then they're also doing, frankly, you write it down. You develop a case. You study what Kiva has done. You study what you have done. You write it down in terms of these were the steps. This is where the failure hit. This was the response. And then you share those. You share those in the classroom. You share those online. Very powerful teaching instruments. So I think that the technology, I've seen this wonderful new technology that, so a friend of mine is starting something called Food Business School, and it's for the Culinary Institute. And he's been working on a startup which basically allows you to have interaction, mentorship online. It's in real time. Mentors sign up to basically be available to students. You take a course. Part of the credit for the course is having hours of mentorship online. And it's visual. It's interactive. It's basically a Skype online for mentorship. That can be scaled all over the world. There's just what you need then is the access to the technology. So one of the things we might talk about here is the need for digital inclusion as well as financial inclusion, which on the gender parity issue is really huge. A lot of what we've heard about are micro enterprises, microfinance, which are going to be headed by or help women. And if you look around the world, one of the great blockages here is digital inclusion. women are not as digitally engaged in many parts of the world as men, and financial inclusion. Put those two things together, and then these ideas can just explode.
Thank you. Dr. Barry, oh, please. We've had the chance to work together in the last couple of years to try to combat and then ameliorate the tragic consequences of Ebola in West Africa. Could you share a little bit about Well Body Alliance, and I think particularly talk about why you chose and have continued to choose, because I know you've had kind of almost limitless options to stay in your home country and to not come to the United States or to go elsewhere. But you've remained so committed and clearly have inspired such commitment in so many of us.
Thank you. I think the main thing, I grew in extreme poverty, and I was inspired by a nurse who was a neighbor, and I wanted to become a doctor, but because of my poverty and family, never went to school, I thought it's impossible. But through the year of growing in poverty and learning how to survive, and in high school, there was a scholarship that was given to the best two students in the country that took the medical school entry exam, and I was fortunate to be in the second best student, and I went to medical school through that. And I learned in medical school, I also, even during medical school, I really suffered. I walked 7 miles back and forth, and I had to handwrite textbooks. But that kind of like taught me and made me to think about what poverty means and how would you like get yourself out of poverty. And I do believe that poverty should not be a deterrent to people creating innovation. So what? But unfortunately, it is. And that kind of like motivates me every day to like kind of work through and work in the community, try to change people's thinking and the way they look at things. And even though when I graduated, most of my colleagues leave the country, I decided to stay and found Well Body Alliance and started working in the community and try to like basically develop people, poor people, and to think and ways that they can grow out of poverty. So I was inspired by the fact that hard work, I worked hard and also sheer luck to get into medical school. And I do believe that people who are like me can also make it if they work hard, and maybe by mere chance of luck, they can really make it. So I stayed, because if we all leave, who's gonna take care of the poor people? Who's gonna take care of those people that stay in that situation? So that kind of like motivate me to stay in my country and continue working for Well Body Alliance.
And could you just explain the vision and ambition of Well Body Alliance for people who may not be as familiar?
Yeah, so Well Body Alliance was founded in 2006 by an American medical student and myself. And our vision is to provide the best care possible for the poorest people in the world. And that's like in Kano District, which is the epicenter of our 10-year war. We had a history of 10-year war. And it's like the most devastated districts in the country. And we went and worked in India, and we built a clinic. But first, we wanted to work in parallel with government. We wanted to develop a system and like that could be like a competition to the government, and government sees that and they can do better. But over the years, I learned that it's difficult to do. So rather, we decided to work with government in the district and help develop the healthcare system. So we develop our clinic, but still work with other government clinics and also develop community health workers. And the most special thing about Well Body Alliance is the fact that it's an indigenous institution, and all the staff are local, they are from the community, and we really value that when we hire staff, that they are from the district, and they know they talk the tribe, and they because when you develop that in the community, it's more powerful. And so we develop community health workers to enable the system where the community health workers will feed into the facility, the clinic. So community health workers go into the community, like for example in HIV AIDS, we train HIV patients to deliver HIV drugs to their colleagues in their houses, and not only deliver, try to understand their problems, try to understand their social determinants to accessing care, and in that way we link them to care and also retain them to care. So, I mean, it's like our organization is mostly rooted in the communities.
Thank you. One of the kind of common threads, certainly, between the three people sitting on my left, although I'm sure Raj and Laura would agree with this as well, is how important it is to engage the people that you're actually trying to empower in designing mm-hmm. their own empowerment, mm-hmm. Which seems obvious, and everyone's nodding, but for a long time was not obvious. I think, Pramal, you've been such an advocate and outspoken kind of champion, and even when necessary, critic for this needing to happen and when it isn't happening. Can you talk about some of the challenges of engaging people, kind of whether it's building solar panels from scrap material in Himalayan villages, or really trying to understand the different technologies that are most accessible in different places, or Raj, from your perspective, how you thought about that in the kind of development lab inception and then in early years? I don't know who wants to go first, but if...
Sure. It's for those of us who do this work, it's easy to talk about it, and then when you're actually doing it, you realize how difficult it can be. And I want to give one example of a Kiva field partner, Honeycare Africa, which is based in Kenya, that won a bunch of business plan competitions. They won a World Bank Award back in 2000 because they had a genius idea. They worked with farmers to put beehives on farming on land. And they would basically, it's great for the farmer in theory, because the farmer would be able to diversify the income stream. So not only kind of the crops, but also honey revenues. And then the bees could actually cross-pollinate with the crops, having greater crop yield. So it was seen like a great idea. They would then basically sell the honey, split the revenues 50-50. And kind of several years later, when Kiva met this local field partner in Kenya, and we went out and walked around and looked at kind of what was happening, a lot of the beehives on the farmer land were basically empty. What was happening? So literally the social enterprise started almost teetering out of existence. And then they brought in new management. And the management, local management, started asking questions. And the most kind of basic question provided kind of a key insight, which is, like you and me, farmers are afraid of bees. And the model that, oh, people would just have beehives and somehow honey, you know, production would work, you know, work great on a business plan, but, you know, in practice, you know, what really worked for this organization was then to add actually a whole network of honey collectors, hire and train honey collectors with the proper equipment to service these beehives and get them going again. And this is the type of stuff that adds cost to the social enterprises model, pushes out their own break-even date to being a sustainable venture. This is why patient capital from the internet community and from investors is so important, because when you have these conversations, when you bump into walls, you're going to learn new things, and oftentimes it's going to set back you know, that point of sustainability. And so I think this is where it's important to have the conversation and also just view this as a very long-term conversation that you have to be willing to adapt to.
So can I just, I just want to quickly build on a couple of points here. So number one, it is the case, I think, that throughout curricula and courses now that are focusing on entrepreneurship, there has developed this concept of the lean launch. And the lean launch is very much the notion that you cannot even come up with a design until you have worked exactly with the users that you're trying to solve a problem for. If you are not interacting with them from the very beginning in terms of design needs, price point, and I'm hearing that from all of you, then the business plan that you've written down is just not, most likely not going to work. So lean launch and design has become very, very important among mentors, judges, and courses. And then the other thing I wanted to say is that, again, to go to the technology point, thinking about your social enterprise or your social enterprise or your business. Again, using technology, there's a wonderful new set of online courses leading to online activities that's been sponsored. It's called Philanthropy University. It's a bit of a misnomer because the university is meant to be a series of online courses and networks to help build capacity for organizations, whether they're nonprofit or profit, whether they're social enterprise or sustainable, to build their capacity to deliver these kinds of services. Because frankly, you can't sit in Washington, D.C. or Berkeley, California, and do this. You actually do have to work with the organization that's doing the providing. So how do you build their capacity? You can build their capacity online. So it's very, I just wanted to get those 2 points in. It's very interactive relative to what I've heard from people trying to solve the problems on the ground.
Raj.
Well, I'll just add a slightly different point, which is I think the concept of lean launch and testing and being willing to admit mistakes and make changes is critical, right? Which is why, and frankly, as you pointed out, a lot of prior programming and development has been the opposite. It was like you did a 400-page proposal, 350 pages of which are fiduciary accountability and accounting. 10 people are qualified to submit it. It costs probably $50,000 to put together, and right away, the vast majority of innovators are excluded from the practice of development. And that's why we created the Development Lab, to have tools and vehicles and mechanisms that were lighter, faster, allowed for failure, allowed for learning, allowed for adaptability. The one thing I do want to point out, though, is if you look across decades of work in global development, the biggest successes have been the things that, by definition, have been able to scale, and often scale not quite on their own, but through different public systems and different private companies, but massive scale. So mobile phones that reach 600-700 million accounts across very low income countries have obviously transformed human connectivity and economic connectivity. Decades ago, hybrid seeds and improved wheat varieties that sparked the Green Revolution saved 300 million people from being on the brink of starvation in Asia and parts of Latin America. And it was, you know, one basic improved seed variety that was then adapted and scaled, because the value, the sheer value of that scientific breakthrough was the difference between having enough food to drive a modern food system or having lots of people go hungry. So even as we test and we're lean in our effort to see what works in the field, I actually think we need to be heavy on the R&D and the investment and the search for the big breakthroughs that'll be transformational. At USAID and and even now, we're involved in West African maize that has improved genetics that can be much more stable during low rainfall years. That improved yield stability will enable a farmer to be making a much more coherent choice to invest in fertilizer, invest in irrigation, improve the core productive system, and has the potential to wipe out the hunger season in East Africa for the vast majority of communities that succumb to it. Those are the types of solutions that I think we still today hugely underinvest in. And I'd like to see billions and billions of dollars of more public sector driven investment that is done with private companies and with scientists and research labs in the Blum Center and Berkeley. But the world has a far greater capacity to invest in innovations to end poverty, and we're just starting to scratch the surface.
Please, Dr. Barrett. Yeah.
I think just to add to what Rajsa said, you see, with innovations, people develop innovations, but one of the things is implementing them and getting the implementation platform where you implement them. And I think one of the things that is very important is to look where you want to implement and work with indigenous institutions that are already there, that know the culture, that know the social interaction that exists. And in that way, I think whatever innovation you develop would be able to be implemented, because most often people develop great, the design and the great programs or whatever, but when it comes to implementing them, they usually fail because they've not worked with indigenous organizations or institutions.
Yeah, and please, you know, Dr. Barry, I know you know, this was one of the kind of many challenges and tensions as the world sort of belatedly woke up to the crisis of Ebola, and certainly kind of something that we were always working to do at the Clinton Foundation was to direct people who did have lots of good intentions to work through the Well Body Alliance or to work through the ministries of health in the places where the ministries of health were robust, to not kind of set up a separate kind of delivery mechanism when there were public or non-public efforts that had already proven to be successful. And I know that you felt that kind of tension very much on the ground. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so I would say just one major thing is that with Ebola outbreak, I'll give an example as the burial practices. People do give these claims of causality that it's the burial practices that caused the Ebola to scale up, to escalate the way it did. Yeah, it's true, but these are basically claims, because with the burial system, system that was put in place was one not so thought through, and it's also had a lot of problems. For example, if there is no enough ambulances to pick up the dead bodies from the communities, and you said people should not bury their dead, should not touch their dead, and that is, I mean, if I call the hotline number and it takes 5 days to come and pick my loved one, what do you expect me to do? I would definitely have to find a way to bury them. So I think that's one problem. And what was actually, and also there was not, they did not provide an alternative solution to the problem by just banning people not to bury their dead or not to touch their dead, and said it's because people were touching their dead or were burying them. So I think if an alternative was given to them, I mean, it would have been a great idea. So as I said, like, cultural practices are very important, but they can change. They can also be changed through resources, if resources are put into the system, and given the situation, it's really going to create a huge change in the cultural practice. For example, in the US, if somebody dies, you don't have to touch your loved one. You don't have to bury, I mean, you bury them, but you don't have to touch them because there are a system in place, people who take care of the dead, and you will just see your loved one in a coffin prepared for you to go and bury. And in Africa, those resources are not in place, and how would you expect someone not to touch or bury their dead one? So I think when we make these claims, we have to think about the other option, the other side of it, like that. Even though people don't, you don't want people to touch their dead, but what else would you provide for them if they don't touch their dead?
Completely agree. Before we get to a couple of the questions on Twitter, you know, Raj, you were not the head of USAID during Ebola, but you were the head of USAID during the aftermath of the Haiti earthquake. Can you talk about kind of what you did kind of from that position to try to engage a local community that had been so horribly traumatized and to kind of avoid these really false choices for people that Dr. Barry talked about, so to avoid kind of unintended consequences that wouldn't have been learning opportunities, but would have been, you know, further tragedies for families that had already suffered so much.
Yeah. Well, thank you. And, you know, actually, not in an unplanned way, I ended up extending my service to wait until we had felt like Ebola was actually at a place where it was managed effectively. And I want to just pick up on Dr. Barry's last comment on Ebola, because the single most effective intervention in Liberia to quickly reduce incidence and prevalence in the October, November timeframe, when Ebola cases went down faster than anyone expected. I mean, we were building thousands of Ebola treatment unit beds.
In 2014.
Exactly. Expecting that we were going to have 30, 40,000 cases by December. We got to December and we had fewer than a few thousand. And the reason was the success of these burial teams. And in Liberia, it was successful because, and I think the Clinton team was involved in this in Liberia, but between the Clinton team, the government of Liberia, and a group called Global Communities, there was a lot of activity, trust, and long-standing engagement with the rural communities, so that when the burial teams went in and explained how to handle a dignified and safe burial without while dramatically reducing transmission risk, they were accepted by those local communities, a point you made earlier. Seeing how rapidly that incidence came down, our colleagues in Sierra Leone tried to replicate that effort, and we had actually modeled out and expected the Sierra Leone reduction in incidence to track Liberia's, and it didn't at all. And it didn't at all because, as you point out, there wasn't that local conversation and trust. And so people saw folks coming in full protective equipment with their faces covered, saying, you know, don't touch your deceased bodies, and we're going to try as quickly as we can to get a WHO approved process for removing the dead bodies. And there was just a lack of trust, a lot of fear, and it was very ineffective at first. And it took actually a couple of months to change the process to make it more effective. So I think it's a great example of your point earlier, that unless you have that deep community knowledge and trust and engagement and respect for those you're serving, you're not going to be effective, and the effectiveness gap is very dramatic. In Haiti, we had a massive challenge because it was such a dramatic collapse of the local economy and the local community. And my first trip with Secretary Clinton a few days after the earthquake, 21 of 22 ministries, including the United Nations, the physical structures had collapsed, and so many of the leaders were deceased or injured. And it was just the capacity to be resilient was very challenged. In that environment, we, with the US military support and lots of NGOs and humanitarian partners, very quickly tried to establish food distribution for 3 million people within 3 weeks, clean water distribution through trucking it in from the Dominican Republic, which was so widespread that 6 months after the earthquake, the diarrheal disease rate in Port-au-Prince was 14% below the rate it was the day before the earthquake itself. And we did a lot of things in that capacity. I'm so glad you mentioned unintended consequence, because the unintended consequence of massive, immediate humanitarian support is it makes it very hard for the local economy to recover. And one of the things we did that I think was controversial at the time, but proved to be very effective, was we tried to reduce the duration for which we were giving out free food and bringing in food from other countries, and instead pivoted to larger investments in helping farmers restart their own agriculture. And today, Haiti's rural agricultural production is up 250% relative to where it was before the earthquake, led by maize and rice and other crops that were part of this Feed the Future program that the United States and scientists and other countries all did with Haitian agricultural scientists and Haitian farmers. And one of the big challenges of our business of providing aid is if you provide too much for too long, it might make you feel good, but it can often make it very, very difficult for local businesses to thrive and to take advantage of these business opportunities to restart their economy. And today, I think we do a lot better job of this. In the typhoon in the Philippines, Typhoon Haiyan, we moved very quickly to investing in local businesses and local organizations to actually do the reconstruction, create significant local employment in the process, and start that mindset of let the local businesses thrive and solve their own problem, maybe with some contracting support from outside organizations. But you go in with that mindset on day one, even as you're looking at absolute devastation. And that has proven to make a big difference in building real resilience in local economies that suffer from these kinds of disasters.
Thank you. We've answered most of the questions on the screen, but to end on, I think, an important question that has been kind of somewhat answered, but to ensure it gets truly answered, Libby asks, how do you encourage people to use the programs that you've developed? And I think it would be helpful kind of for us to end with each of you talking about kind of your answers to this question. But also how you plan to encourage even more people to use the programs that you developed, as well as to be part of developing their futures. So Dr. Barry, and then we'll just go down the row.
Well, I think one of the best ways is engaging the communities you're working with from the start, like from the design and implementing of the program. Because when you, like, basically buying from the community is so important that if they feel it's a foreign idea that is brought to them, they usually kind of like resist it. But if they feel like it's a program that is rooted from their own culture, from their own from their own culture, it's usually like they accept it, because it's like you are there. Like, our organization is local, everybody is local, and we'll go to the communities and we discuss with them and we listen. Basically, one key thing is listening. We listen to them, and when we develop and implement programs.
I want to touch on three different things quickly. The first is related to culture and how you use cultural systems to help spread your projects. For example, when we first started out, we had men see this beautiful sole source solar stove that we developed, fall in love with it, they'd get it and take it home to their wives and say, hey honey, look at what I brought you. It's this beautiful gift. And oh, by the way, can you make my favorite meal on it tonight and have it taste just the same as it always does? So as you can imagine, this was terrifying for the women. So we took a step back and we said, what is the traditional way that women learn within a community? And we saw that it was going to the older women. So we went and we trained the older women how to make exotic recipes on Soul Source, like yak burgers, for example. And those women became so excited about all those recipes they were learning that when they went down to collect water, they talked to all of the other women about it. So it solved three issues. First, it got over the fear barrier and showed women where to go for information. Two, it became an aspirational positioning. All of these respected older women in the community now became sole source advocates. And number three, it became our biggest marketing campaign. So that's one thing I wanted to share with you. Two is how unintended consequences can sometimes actually be helpful for the spread of your work. For example, sole source. We designed it as a cooking device, but many of our customers use it for other things. We have people who are purifying water and making purified water businesses, who are heating up their irons on top of sole source and running a clothing ironing business, building Stirling engines and powering their homes. We even have one community that's processing human waste with sole source and another one that's doing autoclaving. So there's a whole range of things that are unintended consequences that are actually very powerful reasons why people would get sole source in addition to cooking. So instead of pushing back against that, we said, how can we leverage that? How can we show people how this can be a platform and have peer-to-peer learning about all the ways that you can use it? The third thing is business model and local adaptation. We started out up in the Himalayas designing this barter-based business model. But as we've expanded to the 60 different countries where we now have customers, there's been a different business model in every single one of those locations. And it's because we've had great partners and great conversation, you know, listening and learning and speaking with people to understand what will work locally. So in Haiti, for example, we have a rent-to-own model. Here in the United States, people who are looking for greener grills are buying it in e-commerce mechanisms. Right? So it runs the whole gamut. Keep your mind open and look for what are your customers telling you about how they want to use your products and how you can best get it to them.
I would say that it's important to design for love, for something that people love so much that they not only are drawn to using it. So instead of like, how do I get someone to use it? Like, they should love it so much that they're pulling for it. And then I truly believe things will spread. I think it's more important for 10 people, if you're a social entrepreneur here, to love what you're doing than 100 people to kind of like it. So first design for love, then scale, then figure out how that can be scalable.
So I guess I would say something that's come up, I think everyone has mentioned it, is really the role of the public sector here. Last night we talked a lot about public goods. A lot of the things we're talking about could be conceived to be things which a society should support for its disadvantaged population. Society's failing, so we have NGOs, we have philanthropies, we have social enterprises, we have businesses coming in to fill the void. At the end of the day, though, I do think that to scale significantly, you're going to end up with the need for partnering. You're going to need to find a way to work with the fairly significant streams of public money and public outreach to take your great idea, your idea designed for love, your idea that's really solving problems for people, and scale it. And I do think, so I would just end with the notion of partnerships and trying from the early on to figure out a way to work with the public sector to take your great idea and to scale it.
Well, I certainly agree with that, and in hearing Dr. Berry, your description of your personal story, I can't help but conclude that, you know, you've been able to accomplish what you have by thinking big and being persistent under really trying circumstances. And I've personally, you know, have not had that kind of trying set of circumstances. I do think the lesson for us in this field is to continue to think big, and maybe designing for love as opposed to acceptance is one form of thinking big, and expecting your public sector partners and governments to actually perform well and be accountable and be accessible and expand their investments on public goods that should be available to everyone. That's why they're called public goods. Is an example of thinking big. And building businesses and tackling problems and projects that you think, you know, sure, it'll have real impact in a village or in a community or across a certain cohort of the population, but ultimately is going to be a meaningful part of the global fight to end extreme poverty. That's thinking big. Because all of you at this wonderful meeting have the opportunity to be a part of a field in global development that over the next 15 to 20 years actually can virtually wipe out the kind of $1 or $2 a day poverty that we call extreme deprivation and extreme poverty. It's on your watch that we will end the fact that 6.5 million people still die every year under the age of 5. Most of those children die of simple things like diarrhea and pneumonia that are relatively straightforward to solve, and you can develop the solutions. But in my view, if you, even as you go forward and build your businesses, don't ever let anyone get you to, you know, be too much in a box. You're part of a big global movement. CGI has been a leader in this movement. Together we can achieve some amazing things so long as we keep, Dr. Berry, your story in mind and keep thinking big about what we aspire to do together.
So I hope it's now evident kind of why I was so excited at the beginning of the panel and why I have long admired every member of the panel and have either had the privilege of knowing them and supporting them personally or kind of cheering them from afar. I also, before we conclude, just want to mention that this weekend at the Clinton Foundation, we're launching an online platform that we're calling the Impact Library to help share stories like these through peer-reviewed journal articles, so kind of quite academic pieces, complemented by case studies, as Laura mentioned, and toolkits, some of which have been developed by experts here at CGIU and some developed by people that we've never met and never worked with, but deeply respect. We hope that this will be a resource to all of you. We're starting with 2,500 discrete pieces on the Impact Library. We've spent a couple of years building this, but very much it's still in its infancy, although probably 2,500 sounds like a lot. Publications in multiple languages, so not only in English. And we hope that you will tell us what you think, kind of what you find useful. We hope you'll use the ratings function so that other people can kind of benefit, hopefully, from you being early adopters and being kind of some of the first to engage so that this can be organic and responsive to what you feel like would be helpful to accelerate and amplify your efforts. If you have questions, I hope you'll find Astrid. She's from the Clinton Foundation. She'll be at the CGIU Exchange. She'll have tablets to show you the library in action. And if you don't have time this weekend, I certainly hope that you'll log on and take a look and share it with your friends. And while we conclude, I hope that you'll give one just more even enthusiastic and rousing, grateful round of applause to our panel. Thank you very much, everyone.